Thank you all for coming. The Historic Preservation Board, some of you may know, we designate historic sites within Martin County, and we're also trying to put together some historic events throughout the county, throughout the year, and this is one of them, to bring more awareness of the Martin County's history. So, moving forward, today's presentation is on the Ashley Gang, and following will be a film, Little Laura and Big John, a showing of that film. And the presentation will be given by Alice Luckhart. Alice is a native Floridian and graduate of Florida State University in 1972. Alice taught 7th grade social studies at Stewart Middle School for 18 years. From 1990 to 2000, she and her husband, Greg, operated the family business of Lucky's Flea Market. During the 2000s, she researched and wrote many true historical and genealogical stories that were published in national and local magazines. Several books have been written by Alice, the most recent being Did You Know? And Stewart, with a collection of 200 vintage local photos. She placed third in the nation in 2010 for an outstanding genealogical magazine article. Several online genealogical sites, including Ancestry.com, have hired her to write content and blogs for their websites. Since 2012, Alice and Greg have researched, wrote, and produced a weekly column for Your News in Stewart News titled Historical Vignettes about the forgotten and lesser known people, events, and places in Martin County over the decades. For that work, in October 2013, they were selected as the Martin County Historical Preservationists of the Year and awarded a trophy by the Martin County Historic Preservation Board. Alice also serves as an officer on the Board of Directors for the Stewart Heritage Museum since April 2010. For Stewart's 100th anniversary, she was the historical coordinator and presenter for 2014 Century in Review, a live 90-minute program at the Lyric Theater. She has worked with Stewart Main Street on the Sailfish historical markers and with the city's officials and county veterans to have a local fallen veteran honored each Memorial Day since 2014. She worked in 2015 with the television production team for the American Heroes Channel for making of an episode about the local notorious Ashley Gang. On December 9th, 2016, Alice was also one of 10 females in the country awarded Women in American History by the national and local Daughters of the American Revolution organization for her work in historical research. She continues across the county to present historical talks to private and public venues. Please welcome to the stage Miss Alice Luckhart. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I'm so glad we have such a wonderful turnout here. Great. We've been a little delayed because they're trying to work on the sound system. So when we are ready to start, we'll check to see with everybody that you can hear. You know, but before it was hard to tell with everybody talking. But I'm going to give you a little background here. I've put together this video about the Ashley Gang. I'd actually started some 12 years ago, and I got some of my greatest amount of information from the chief of police's son. His name is Jim Pageant. The chief of police of Stewart during this time was Obie Pageant. And I contacted the son, because I knew Obie had already passed away by this time, and I said, do you have anything in reference to the Ashley Gang or what your father did here? And he said, well, by the way, my father did happen to write everything down for the family, you know, sort of like a journal or a diary. So he sent me copies of that. I kind of put it all together so it made some sense, and it was a world of information, you know, something you're just not going to find anywhere else. Yes, a few other people have written books on the Ashley Gang, but I thought this one coming from the chief of police of the city of Stewart who chased the Ashley Gang, you can't get much better, you know, authorization than that. So that's what I've used. Not the only thing. Of course, I really believe in doing a variety of research. I never base anything just on one entity or one source. So what you see that I put together here, there were no actual videos of the Ashley Gang back in the 1910s and 1920s. But what I've done is put together photographs, maps, drawings, whatever, that fit the story. And I take you through from beginning to end. And then after this is concluded, before we start the movie, Little Laura Big John, I will tell you some new information on some of the Ashley members and what I found out in more recent years since I made this video. So there's quite a bit to be learned, and I'm still learning new things on the family. And I will also tell you about some of the background on this movie, Little Laura Big John, which was actually filmed here in Stewart in the late 60s. And I have met the screenwriter and producer of that movie. He has passed away since then, but I did get to meet him and talk to him many times. So I have that background, I have that information, and that's why I'm sharing it with all of you. So we're going to be ready to start. Afterwards, I'll take if there's any questions, and then we'll do the other movie.
Step back in time to the days of the ruthless Ashley Gang, notorious outlaws in Stewart's early history, and the man who was there at their demise in 1924, Chief O.B. Paget. In an era before the 1930s and the big-time gangsters, there were bank robberies, illegal liquor, and murders. Before John Dillinger, Babyface Nelson, Pretty Boy Floyd, and the infamous Bonnie and Clyde. However, the Ashley Gang was ahead of their time. Florida had the Ashley Gang, known as murderers, bank robbers, train robbers, bootleggers, rum runners, and kidnappers. It started with John Henry Ashley, born March 19, 1888, in Birmingham, Lee County, Florida, near Fort Myers. His father was Joe Julius, born May 1860 in Lafayette County, Florida. His mother was Lugenia. They lived in Key West from 1880 to about 1885, then moved near Fort Myers where John was born. Joe Ashley was a farmer. The family moved to Pompano on the East Coast about 1904. The Ashley family settled in Gomez near Hobe Sound in 1911. The home they built was called Twin Oaks. John was an expert marksman, shooting a whiskey bottle at 30 paces and putting the bullet through the bottle's neck. The father and sons farmed, hunted, and worked for the Flagler Railroad, cutting lumber. John Ashley served in the Florida State Militia as a private for 5 months, sometime between 1908 and 1910. All the young Ashley brothers learned how to live off the land, especially the swamps of the Everglades. It was their second home. The Ashleys knew and traded with the Seminole Indians. Things were about to change dramatically. On December 29, 1911, Seminole Indian DeSoto Tiger was found dead west of Fort Lauderdale, and his animal hides had been sold in Miami. John, having been the last one with DeSoto, was now sought by Sheriff George B. Baker for the murder of DeSoto Tiger, who was the son of Tommy Tiger, head of the Cow Creek Seminoles. John Ashley, learning he was wanted, decided to escape out of Florida. A reward was posted for his capture. John went out to the state of Washington and worked the logging camps. The Ashley family remained in the Gomez area at their home called Twin Oaks. John's younger siblings, Eva, Frank, and Daisy, attended school in 1912 in Stewart. The youngsters' names appeared on a 1912 Christmas greeting from their principal. Eva was in seventh grade. Frank in fifth grade, and Daisy in third grade. John became homesick and tired of being hounded. He returned to Florida in May 1914 to turn himself in. to Sheriff George Baker. He was jailed immediately. John admitted he killed DeSoto Tiger, but in self-defense, after DeSoto demanded liquor from John. July 3, 1914. The first trial in West Palm Beach was a mistrial. 9 for acquittal and 3 for conviction. The second trial was to be held in Dade County later in 1914. But while being taken to the Dade jail before the trial, John managed to escape from Deputy Sheriff Bob C. Baker, son of Sheriff George B. Baker. He cut through some chicken wire and had vanished into the Glades. Another reward of $1,000 was posted since he had escaped, but no one turned him in, possibly out of fear. While John was in hiding, his gang was assembled. There were family members along with professional bank robbers from Chicago. The Ashleys would include John, his brother Bob, and another young man called Kid Lowe, who had joined up from Chicago. The Ashley gang was now official. February 7, 1915. There was a train robbery of number 33 Palm Beach Limited that Sunday night near Stewart. Ashley and his gang tried to rob a Florida East Coast Railway train. That Sunday night, after the southbound number 33 started to pull out of the Stewart station, which was located across from St. Lucie Avenue, four gang members boarded from the rear of the train, displaying their guns to the flagmen. Also in the first car were three women. One managed to run in the opposite direction and into the other car to notify the porter. The porter immediately locked the door to the rear coach. The gang took money from the other two women and a sack from the flagman. They directed the people to head for the next car. The car door was locked and the flagman did not have a key. The gang ordered the train stopped, which the flagman was able to do. They moved to the rear of the last coach, and when the train was stopped, 1 mile south of Stewart, all four gang members jumped off and scrambled into the woods. The train went on to the West Palm Beach station to report the robbery. The posse that was sent out was led by Sheriff George B. Baker, who had been sheriff since 1909. The Florida East Coast Railroad posted a $500 reward. A few days later, the sheriff arrested John's father, Joe Ashley, and a couple other men at the Ashley home, but they were all later released. John and his gang were hiding safely in the hammocks of the Everglades, just waiting for their next opportunity. 2 weeks later, February 23, 1915, Tuesday morning, the Ashley gang arrived on the 9:30 a.m. train to Stewart. The two brothers, John and Bob, met at the Stewart Bank building where they were joined by Kid Lowe, who was already in Stewart. All were familiar with the area, the stores, and of course the bank hours. The bank was on the corner of St. Lucie Avenue and Osceola, next to Stewart's first post office building. They had no vehicle and the gang was not masked. The cashiers were Wallace, Tyndall, Taylor, and Bentle. They were armed with rifles and guns, and everyone knew they meant business. They stole $4,235, but didn't get all the bank's money. The gang took a customer, Frank Coventry, in his Model T car to get out of town. All three were in the back seat, with one holding a gun to Frank's head as he drove the car. Shooting wildly back towards town, a bullet from Kid Lowe's gun struck a window frame, then ricocheted, hitting John in his left jaw, then traveled to the right eye where it lodged. As a result, John lost sight in that eye. John said of that robbery, "Hell of a bank and the amount hardly worth coming for," as they drove with Coventry to Port Sewell, where the gang had a car waiting for them. They told Frank Coventry to drive directly back to Stewart. The news of the robbery was covered in all the newspapers. Two posse set out in search, which included 20 Stewart citizens. Sheriff George B. Baker sent out messages to Miami and other areas to watch for the gang. the Stewart Bank was still able to open for business, as it had reserves which were not taken. The gang had gone 15 miles southwest of Stewart into their hammock camp area. Kid Lowe and Bob Ashley let brother Bill Ashley know where John was, and they went off with the money. Bill went out to the camp to assist John. The sheriff followed Bill to the hammock camp, where John surrendered. He was taken to West Palm Beach for medical attention, then arrested. The posse later burned the camp where John was found. John was back in jail by February 25th, Thursday afternoon. He refused surgery to take the bullet out of his head, but his right eye was removed, after which he wore an eye patch or glass eye. March 4th, West Palm Beach Jail. Witnesses to be called. John E. Taylor of Stewart was first summoned as a witness for March 9th. Then March 22nd. John Ashley was moved to a Miami jail to await trial. He had too many friends around the Palm Beach County area. In 1915, articles in the Stewart newspaper, as well as citizens, were critical and mad at their hometown robbers, taking money from their own bank. March 26, 1915. John was tried in Miami for the murder of DeSoto Tiger, found guilty on April 6, 1915, and sentenced to death by hanging. The Ashley family wasn't happy about John sitting in jail, sentenced to death. Some would take matters into their own hands. Miami, June 2, 1915. Brother Bob Ashley, along with two other gang members, one being Kid Lowe, tried to get John out of the jail on First Avenue. Wilbur Henderson, the jailer, was shot to death by Bob Ashley at the jailer's home as he tried to get the keys to the jail. Bob Ashley was killed as he shot at Miami police officer Riblett in a gun battle at 8th Street and Avenue I in Miami. John R. Riblett had joined the Miami Police Department earlier in 1915. John later died from his wounds. National newspaper headlines reported the failed attempt to free John Ashley at a cost of three lives. Kid Lowe stole a car and drove north, getting as far as Macon, Georgia. He got into a fight and shot a man. Lowe was tried and found guilty, then confined to a Georgia prison camp. By 1916, he escaped into the Georgia swamps, not to be found. John Ashley remained in jail. By early November 1915, he had worked for weeks digging out of the Miami jail using a spoon for a shovel. But the Miami guards had been watching and knew about it. They stopped John when he was within 2 feet of breaking out. Late 1915 to early 1916, John sat in jail while America enjoyed the height of the ragtime era. Songs like In Florida Among the Palms, music, bands playing, and jazz becoming very popular. Songs such as Alexander's Ragtime Band, Danny Boy, and Frankie and Johnny. John missed the ladies, no females to comfort him. The one-eyed bandit thought his days were numbered, with only the gallows in his future. In a major change, August 11, 1916, the Supreme Court of Florida reversed the John Ashley death sentence and his guilty verdict for killing DeSoto Tiger. But John would still have to stand trial for the 1915 Stewart Bank robbery. In mid-November 1916, before the trial started on the charge for the Stewart Bank robbery, John pleaded guilty and was sentenced to 17 and a half years. He arrived at Rayford Prison in Stark, Florida on November 23, 1916. This was the big time penitentiary. He was far from his family and his beloved Everglades. The dashing John made a grand entrance. Wearing his eye patch and a new suit, he appeared more like a businessman than a prisoner. His prison number was 12501. John became a fine, well-behaved prisoner at Rayford. He mixed well with the other inmates, but he was always looking for an opportunity to escape. On June 5, 1917, John's war draft form was filled out, just as required of all males, in jail or not. On the form, which is now on record with the National Archives, he listed his physical handicap, right eye missing. He then signed it, John Henry Ashley. Between 1916 and 1921, Joe Ashley, John's father, and the gang members were making moonshine and had stills in Palm Beach and Okeechobee counties. They were blamed, sometimes incorrectly, just about every major crime that took place in South Florida. Kid Lowe was found and captured in Alabama and brought back to Palm Beach County in August 1917. By March 31, 1918, John had been transferred to a prison road camp in Milligan, Florida. It was hard labor, but at least the prisoners were not behind bars. In John's crafty mind, a door of opportunity was opening up. He had escaped by June 1918 with Tom Maddox, another prisoner who was also a bank robber. They headed back south towards the Everglades and the Ashley home. Events in America were changing. 1918 finds a major outbreak of the Spanish influenza. Everyone feels at risk. Precautions and quarantines become the norm. The number of deaths from the disease are enormous worldwide. By November 1918, America at war with Germany had ended. However, there are changes on the horizon for America that John sees as profitable. Prohibition of alcohol becomes the law of the country on January 16, 1919, and enforcement was begun in January 1920. But in Florida, liquor was made in backwoods stills or brought in from the Bahamas. There weren't enough law enforcement agents to control the making and importing of liquor. The Ashley Gang expanded its operation during the period of Prohibition, engaging in moonshining, rum running, and hijacking. There was big money to be made. The Roaring Twenties found everyone looking for a good time. It meant thousands of speakeasies, which were places for people to drink illegal liquor. John and his gang were taking full advantage of this new opportunity. In 1920, Deputy Bob Baker succeeded his father, Sheriff George C. Baker, who died March 1920. Bob becomes the new sheriff for Palm Beach, which included Stewart. About 1920, John met 24-year-old Laura Bell Up the Grove. She had been married to Edgar A. Tillman, who was a marine engineer since about 1916. They had two sons, Clarence Vincent Tillman, born about 1917, and Sidney J. Tillman, born February 8, 1919. Bored with married life, Laura left her husband Tillman and the children. She met John Ashley near Gomez, across the intercoastal at a mangrove region called Pex Lake. Laura joined the gang and served to warn of anyone around the hidden camps, checking out situations for banks to rob. She carried a .38 caliber revolver and knew how to shoot. Smuggling continues to be profitable for the gang. Even setbacks like Joe and Bill Ashley being arrested during 1920 in Sebring for bootlegging didn't halt their activities. Stealing vehicles, whether to transport liquor or to use as a getaway car, then abandoning them. Reports of as many as 30 in a month. Robbing banks, up and down the coast, small town banks or larger city banks, it didn't matter. Roy Shorty Lynn, a U.S. Army deserter, joined the gang in its activities. They checked the bank's hours to be sure it would be open when they arrived. Noted for just saying their name, Ashley, when they entered a bank, everyone knew what was about to happen. In and out of a bank, then back into the glades, where many a lawman feared to travel. There were different members to the gang over the years, but there were always family members who knew every dirt back road and every turn. Deep into the bush, among the twisted vines, or into the swampy marshes, this was their perfect hideout. A message to Sheriff Bob Baker: come on out to the glades and get me. John was caught making a delivery of liquor in the town of Wachula, west of Sebring, in June 1921. It was a small town, and someone recognized him and notified the police. Soon after, in June 1921, John Ashley was returned to Rayford Prison. Having been out of Rayford since his 1918 escape, he fit right back in. Prison life again. John was always looking for the possibility to escape. The Ashley Gang's illegal activities continued even without him. They were known for helping those in need, but they were still criminals and laughing at the law. Orrin B. Pageant, known as O.B. from Taylor County, Florida, came to Stewart in 1920 to work and live. He met some of the Ashley family in Gomez through a friend from Okeechobee, but he never met John. In 1922, Pageant was a deputy under Sheriff Bob Baker, working in Stewart. He took his job seriously, enforcing the law, and was especially hard on moonshiners and bootleggers. At age 24, he was tall and strong, the type of frontier lawman needed in the area. With rivers and inlets all along the Stewart coast, it was a full-time job, keeping the smugglers from overrunning the territory. October 21, 1921, two other Ashley sons, Frank and Ed, died at sea on a run from the Bahamas with illegal alcohol. They had raided liquor stores in the British Bahamas and were wanted by British authorities for piracy on the high seas. The Bank of Stewart relocated in a new building across the street, on the corner of St. Lucie Avenue and Osceola. May 12, 1922, 11:45 a.m., Friday morning, three gang members, Hanford Mobley, nephew of John Ashley, Roy Young Matthews, and John Clarence Middleton, approached the new bank building. John was still at Rayford. The Seminole Bank now occupied the former bank site. Hanford Mobley was dressed as a woman, wearing a hat and veil, as the three walked into the bank. Besides Mobley, there was John Clarence Middleton and Roy Young Matthews. The cashiers were told to hold up their hands and back away from the counter. The robbers carried revolvers and high-powered rifles. One of the men took the money out of the cash drawer and the silver off the racks. In this heist, the gang got $8,135.14. Before leaving the room, they tried to lock the cashiers in the vault, but they couldn't get it locked. The Buick they had stolen was parked in front of the bank. They headed southeast to 4th Street, then crossed the railroad tracks, turned west to Avenue C, to 3rd Street, Avenue D, then headed north. A mile from Fort Pierce, they exchanged the Buick for Ford and proceeded to Okeechobee. Sheriff Baker had been notified and he raced north towards Fort Pierce. City Marshal Hicks C. Stewart had trailed the gang and met with Baker in Fort Pierce. The abandoned Buick was found, containing female clothes and a hat with a veil. The boys are in the headlines again. After 2 days, on May 14th, Sheriff Baker and Posse caught up with Mobley and Middleton in Plant City. Roy Young Matthews had escaped to Georgia. Matthews was captured in Georgia on May 23rd. By June 1922, Hanford Mobley and Roy Matthews escaped from the Broward jail by tying blankets together and sliding down from the roof. Middleton remained in jail and was sentenced to 15 years in prison at his trial. O.B. Pageant traveled with several of the sheriff posses, when looking for the gang members. He enjoyed his law enforcement work. By June 1, 1924, the city of Stuart approved his application for the city marshal position. The title was later changed to chief of police. Paget was proud of his shiny badge. John Ashley had been a model prisoner at Rayford and worked on a road gang again. In 1923, he escaped from the road camp by bribing a guard. He headed straight for the Everglades. Two other members, Ray Lynn and John Clarence Middleton, also escaped from the Marianna, Florida prison and met up with John Ashley. John was back with Laura. Hanford Mobley, after his escape, went to California. Roy Matthews was found years later, sometime after 1924. With John back in control and most gang members available, the illegal stills, moonshine making, hijacking other smugglers' liquor, and stealing cars all increased. Each time they retreated back into the Everglades for protection. Into the swamps, into the mangroves and palms and underbrush. Steal a vehicle to transport hijacked liquor. The hatred between Sheriff Bob Baker and John Ashley only intensified. Especially when the sheriff saw how many times Ashley got away with crimes and escaped. The sheriff raided every still he could locate. The big one came January 9, 1924 at 6 a.m. Baker, with sheriff deputies and a 50-man posse, performed a surprise raid on the Ashley stills, 1.5 miles from the Ashley home in Gomez, near Hope Sound. Guns were blazing, as there was a major gun battle. Deputy Fred Baker and Joe Ashley were killed. It was believed that gang member Arthur Miller shot Fred Baker. Deputy Fred Baker was a cousin of Sheriff Bob Baker. Once again, the gang made national headlines across the country. Laura Upthegrove was injured in the hip, but John escaped. Family members, including John's sisters and mother, were taken to jail. After the family members were taken away to jail, their homes were set on fire by outraged citizens. John escaped deep into the Glades and met up with gang members who were not at the January gun battle. As the months rolled by, the gang needed money. Feeling the sheriff had backed off some, a new plan was developed. The Pompano Bank, located at Northeast 1st Street and Northeast 1st Avenue, was robbed on September 12, 1924. Gang members John Ashley, Ray Lynn, Joe Tracy, and John Clarence Middleton used a .45 caliber revolver and automatic rifles. Joe Tracy drove the getaway car. The tradition continued of leaving a bullet as a token reminder from John Ashley for Sheriff Bob Baker. Once again, the gang escaped into the Everglades, close to Canal Point, east of Lake Okeechobee. A sheriff's posse spent days in the Glades searching for the gang without locating them. However, in October 1924, Joe Tracy was captured and in jail by November 1st. He had a falling out with John Ashley. Hanford Mobley was back in Florida and convinced John and the gang to leave Florida and head for California. George Marriott, who was John Ashley's brother-in-law, was a friend of Paget and he trusted him. Early Saturday morning, November 1, 1924, George Marriott was in Stuart loading his Ford touring car with supplies. He motioned Chief Paget over to the car and whispered something to him. Sheriff Bob Baker was up for re-election in 4 days, and on November 1, 1924, he was giving a speech in Lake Worth. George had told OB that John and three of the gang members were leaving the area that night, driving up the coast to Jacksonville and hiding out at the home of John's sister, Daisy. From there, they would head west to California. They drove north over Dixie Highway, stopping in Fort Pierce for some clothes and a haircut. Chief Pageant immediately contacted Palm Beach Sheriff Bob Baker by phone and let him know of the information. Baker told Pageant he would immediately send up three of his deputies, L.B. Thomas, Henry Stubbs, and Elmer Pageant, a distant cousin of O.B. The four men met in Stuart to devise a plan for capturing the Ashley Gang. One idea was stopping them at the North Bridge over the St. Lucie River in Stuart, but that wouldn't work, since the gang was still in familiar territory and would be on guard for anything suspicious. It was decided that they needed to go to Fort Pierce and bring in Sheriff John R. Merritt. He was sheriff of St. Lucie County. After meeting with the St. Lucie sheriff, it was suggested by Merritt that the best location for a capture was the Sebastian Bridge over the inlet. Merritt called in two additional men as deputies, O.E. Wiggins and Fort Pierce Chief J.M. Smith, to join the group. They drove north in two cars to the Sebastian Inlet. Arriving by sunset, all were confident the gang had not come through yet, as they had spent some time in Fort Pierce before continuing north. After reaching the bridge, Sheriff Merritt had a chain strung across the south entrance, on which was a red lantern hung in the center, so that all traffic would have to stop. Sheriff Merritt and L.B. Thomas drove across the bridge and hid their cars, then walked back across the bridge to join the others. They all took cover in the high grass and weeds along the road approaching the bridge, just waiting. Around 10:30 p.m., a car with two U's from Sebastian was stopped and then motioned quickly across the bridge. Right behind was a Ford touring car, which drove up to within 15 feet of the red lantern and stopped. At that instant, six shotguns were aimed right at the occupants' heads. Deputy L.B. Thomas came up on the right side, took his flashlight, and peered in. "That's John Ashley sitting right there. Look at his one eye. That's him." Sheriff Merritt opened the right front door of the Ford and ordered the first man, John Clarence Middleton, also known as Bob, to get out of the car. They all had their hands up in the air. After Middleton was out, Thomas searched him thoroughly, found no weapon, and then handcuffed him. Thomas reached into the car, pulled out two pistols and a rifle, and handed them to Chief O.B. Pageant. Sitting in the back seat, John Ashley was told to slide out of the car, at which time Thomas retrieved a .38 revolver from a homemade deerskin holster that John was wearing. After he was out, Ashley was searched and handcuffed, then lined up in front of the car. Following the same procedure, the remaining two, Hanford Mobley, driver of the car, and Ray Shorty Lynn, got out, was searched, and handcuffed as four deputies had their guns trained on the outlaw's every move. Ashley was handcuffed individually, while the other three men were handcuffed together, with instructions for none of them to move a muscle. Sheriff Merritt took the chain down, then he and Thomas walked back across the bridge to get their automobiles, then drove back over to park in front of the bandit's car. Merritt called to OB to bring over the confiscated weapons to put in the car trunk. As Chief Pageant headed toward the vehicle, he heard Henry Stubbs suggest to Elmer Pageant, "Elmer, do you want to kill John?" Elmer said, "Might as well, and get it over with." In a calm manner, although facing the immediate probability of being killed right there, John Ashley requested something to drink and then permission to remove his hat. As he reached up to take his hat off, apparently all four deputies fired at the bandits at the same time. All four outlaws were killed by shots of 12-gauge buckshot, as was observed by O.B. Pageant. Neither Sheriff Merritt, L.B. Thomas, nor O.B. fired a weapon. The Ashley Gang was now history. The news spread very quickly throughout the country of the demise of the four notorious gang members at the Sebastian Bridge. On the night of November 1st, the bodies were placed in the Ford and driven to the Fort Pierce Mortuary on 2nd Street and Avenue A, all with handcuffs still in place. John Ashley had about $100 in his pocket, now riddled with bullet holes. The following morning, the bodies were displayed on the sidewalk by the mortuary for the public to view. People came from Stewart and West Palm Beach to see the spectacle. There was a coroner's investigation and a coroner's jury about John Ashley and his three companions being killed by the sheriff's posse. Chief Padgett was never able to testify, since he had come down with acute indigestion due to eating some spoiled meat. Padgett had been confined by the doctor to the St. Lucie Sheriff's office to rest. The final ruling by the jury, within a couple of days, was justifiable homicide, since the remaining deputies' statements all affirmed that the gang had tried to escape. The deputies had said, "It was them or us." The final inquest and jury ruling on November 8, 1924, stated the shootings were a case of justifiable homicide. Gang member Roy Matthews was found years later, after 1924, and put back in prison. At the Ashley Cemetery in Gomez, services were conducted by the Salvation Army. Ray Shorty Lynn, having no relatives, was buried with John Ashley and Hanford Mobley at the family cemetery. John Clarence Middleton was buried in another location by his family. DeSoto Tiger's family now felt his death had been avenged. Laura Updegrove continued getting into minor problems with the law, serving additional time in prison. On August 10, 1927, while working with her mother at a filling station at Updegrove Beach near Lake Okeechobee, Laura became outraged at a customer who was trying to buy liquor from her. She killed herself by drinking Lysol disinfectant in front of her mother and witnesses. Haywood Register, one of the last known gang members who had been at Rayford, escaped prison in early December 1928. In January 1929, he was caught and killed in a shootout with Sheriff Bob Baker in Palm Beach County. George Carlo Mario, the informant and brother-in-law to John Ashley, died from drowning on December 2, 1932, in the St. Lucie Canal in Martin County. He was in a rowboat with Bill Ashley when the boat overturned. George drowned, but Bill survived. Sheriff Robert C. Baker, born July 12, 1888 in Florida, and a lawman since 1909, died February 23, 1933 of a heart condition in West Palm Beach. Bill Ashley died April 22, 1940 in Martin County. The mother, Lugenia Ashley, died November 14, 1946 in Martin County. Joe Tracy remained in prison for decades and died there in 1968. Many Ashley and Mobley descendants have changed their surname through the years. After the gang's demise in 1924, only about $32,000 was recovered. Maybe more money is still hidden in the Glades. Between 1911 and 1924, they were responsible for at least a dozen deaths. The building, which housed the original Stewart Bank, which was robbed in 1915, still stands in downtown Stewart. Today, the building serves as a fellowship hall. Crossing Osceola Street decades earlier, the present-day building was a bank, grocery store, department store, 5-10-cent store, and numerous restaurants, including the former Ashley restaurant with its memorabilia of the gang and possibly a ghost or two. The Hollywood movie made in Stewart in 1969 and released in 73 as Little Laura, Big John, starred Fabian and Karen Black. Unfortunately, the movie was mostly fiction in its depiction of the Ashley gang. A very special thanks to the following people and sources which assisted in putting this material together.
You see the moderator, the narrator that we have? That's my husband, Greg. He doesn't think he has a good voice, but everybody's always loved any narration he does, so I always thank him for doing that. What I'm going to cover with you now before I take some questions is some of the unusual things that I've learned about the Ashley Gang since I did this video. One is about the mother, Lugenia, the mother of John and the other boys, and her maiden name was Clay, C-L-A-Y. She was born in Tampa, the West Coast there, 1862, and her parents were originally from Georgia. Her father came down to Tampa for a new life in 1859, notice even before the Civil War, lived in Fort Myers. He was a farmer, but what he was most known for was a liquor maker. He made liquor, mostly illegal liquor. And in fact, he made so much that the area where he did his stills was eventually called Whiskey Creek, over there by Fort Myers, and it is to that day still known as Whiskey Creek. Some of the earlier Clay ancestors were from Georgia also, and then from Virginia, particularly the western side of Virginia. One particular ancestor was Mitchell Clay. He even served in the American Revolutionary War, so he was a patriot. The Clay family actually goes back to John Clay, who was born in Wales, part of the United Kingdom. He was born there in 1587. And he comes to the Jamestown colony in Virginia as an English soldier in charge of a whole platoon to protect the colony against the Indians at Jamestown. And remember, Jamestown had already started in 1607, so he comes a few years later. And he's so impressed with Jamestown, this new start, that even after he was no longer had to serve as a soldier, he continued to live there, got married, and had his family. So that's where the Clay family started, was in Jamestown. Another unusual thing was one of the siblings, that John had four brothers, remember, and four sisters. One of the brothers was named Bill, William, the actual name that Bill he was known as. He was born in 1883, and he was always considered the good Ashley, you know, the good one, because he never got in problems like the other brothers did. But I have some more to that story. He did serve as a lookout many times and would help bail out the brothers where he could. But the problem is, how did that family come from Fort Myers over here to the East Coast, first in Pompano and then up to the Gomez area? By the way, that Gomez area where their property is actually located is known as Fruta. Fruta. That name came in about 1910, a gentleman who had developed that area and was growing fruit trees. So he named the area Fruta. So very few know that, but that's exactly what the name is. But anyhow, the family was living in Fort Myers at the turn of the century, 20th century. And there was an incident around 1900 where there was a major fight or scuffle that happened between a local muscular bully who was named Daniel Cash, C-A-S-H, and Bill's younger brother, John Ashley. John was only 15 at the time, but a bit scrawny compared to this muscular fella. Well, Daniel was very upset that young John Ashley could shoot a gun better than Daniel could. So he's going to beat up on John. Well, Bill, the brother, he's 21. He's not about to see his younger brother get beat up by this bully. So he jumps on him and is trying to get him to stop because the bully's actually trying to strangle John. He could have died. There's a lot of noise and commotion. The father is nearby, Joe. He comes over and helps out. And between Joe and Bill, they're trying to pull this bully, Daniel, off of John because he was just literally grabbing him by the throat and was strangling him. So what the father does, he happens to have an axe with him. He takes the back end of the axe and hits Daniel in the head. Well, that did kill Daniel. So his injuries were fatal. The local sheriff, of course, heard the full story of what was happening, and they was just considered involuntary manslaughter, and each were only charged, that's Bill and his father, $250 for the incident. No jail time, nothing like that. Well, you can imagine the local residents in Fort Myers were not thrilled. Even though they may not have liked Daniel, they didn't think that was appropriate punishment for the Ashley boys there. So they got all kinds of resentment and problems from the public. So they finally decided, let's go over to the east coast of Florida. Let's leave Fort Myers. So that's what they did. And they started first in Pompano just for a few years and then come up to this area near Gomez. Bill, of course, marries while he's over here on the East Coast. The woman he married was Bertha Rogers. They married in 1906. Of course, the rest of the family is getting into all kinds of problems during the 1910s and 1920s. After the death of John and the end of the gang, Bill, the only brother left, still continues to be a very favorable man in this area because he was an expert hunting guide. A lot of people employed him to take him out into the wilderness to find, you know, game and deer, and he was excellent at that. One day, it's in March 1931, Bill with his wife are driving home in their vehicle, and Bill had just a little too much to drink. You know, he did like the sauce. And so his wife says, "That's it, move over, I'm driving." Well, she wasn't a very experienced driver, but she figured she was better than Bill right now. She gets in the car, she's driving, they have a flat tire, it blows out, and it causes the vehicle to turn over and over, and she is killed. Bill's wife is killed in that. He has injuries, but he does survive. So he had that major tragedy too. Then in early December 1932, Bill's working with his brother-in-law, George Carlos Morrow, that we saw here, and who had married his sister, Lola, and they were working for the State Highway Company to find pilings for a new bridge that was going in. That's the reason they were in the boat in the South Fork of the St. Lucie River. And the story that Bill gave was that they both kind of leaned over. George fell out of the boat, so did Bill. Bill could swim, he comes back to the shoreline, but he couldn't retrieve and find George, and that George supposedly drowned. They had people looking for even George's body for days. Eventually, it is found on the shore, quite a distance away from where the boat turned over. A lot of people are very suspicious of what really maybe happened that day, because it was just those two out in the boat with nobody else around. And of course, it was always known that the Ashley family liked to get revenge. And remember, they may have found out that it was George who tipped off Chief Padgett that the family was heading north, November 4th, 1924. So Bill was never charged with anything. He does die of a heart attack in April 1940. And then the mother again in 1946. So that's pretty much the end of the, you know, main part of the family. Now then we have the story of Laura Up the Grove. Remember, she never marries into the family. She's just the girlfriend of John. But there's some interesting things about Laura that I've uncovered over the years, not only during the times that she was John's girlfriend, but even after his death. And all I'm going to say is she always wanted a man in her life at any time. And while John was away at Rayford, remember twice, she got lonely, okay? The rest of that story about Laura and some other things will be in an upcoming article with the Indian River Magazine. They are publishing my article about the backstory on Laura Up the Grove. That'll be coming out in March. They said maybe June, but more than likely March issue. So the Indian River Magazine, look for that story on Laura. So there's so many interesting things about the Ashley family that I'm still uncovering and discovering, and I get to talk to several members of the family in one form or another, those who married in or those who were born into the family. So it's always fascinating. Another thing was when we found out, of course, about this movie being made, that was in the late 60s, that they made it and filmed right here in Stewart. So before we start that, Jordan is going to come up and he has something to announce.
All right, can we all give Alice a round of applause? Thank you. So thank you all for coming, appreciate it. Have a good day.